You ever see one of these? It's called a GPS, which stands for, well, who cares? The point is, this thing uses satellites to tell you where you are, which means that every man can have a $500 reason not to ask for directions. But that isn't nearly as good as what I've come up with. I got myself these animal tags that have the little transmitters in them they use to track animals. You've probably seen them on those nature shows where some animal lovers are trying to protect the species by shooting them with a tranquilizer dart and then stapling one of these in their ear. Well, here's what I've done. I've made earrings, and I put one of those little transmitters into every pair. But here's the best part. I made a whole whack of these earrings, and I gave the prettiest pair to my wife, Bernice. She's out right now, but I'm sure she's wearing them, okay? That's way better than GPS, eh? Because GPS only tells me where I am. Hey, if I'm having a good time, I don't care where I am. But with these transmitting earrings, every time Bernice comes home early or saunters out to the garage to see where the smoke is coming from, this baby starts beeping, which gives me time to hide the damage or at least come up with an excuse. Oh, man. She wasn't due back for a couple hours. Hi, honey. Experience last night, and when I got home, Bernice was standing there wearing her coat, and I couldn't smell dinner cooking or anything, and I noticed that the power was still on, and then it struck me, it's our anniversary. So I decided to take her out to the dinner theater up in Port Asbestos because she'd already bought tickets for that.
Uncle Red! You went out last night, yeah.
Last night.
How was the dinner theater?
Oh, my gosh. And I'll tell you, that Shea Ralph's, it's a ripoff, okay?
Oh.
$30, right? You get three little potatoes. Mm-hmm. You get a dinner roll like a golf ball. And I'm talking with the backspin. Okay? and they give you some kind of a Cornish chicken thing that had the muscle mass of a chihuahua.
Well, you know what they say. A fool and his money.
Eat at Ralph's.
And the play, oh man, brutal,
yeah,
brutal.
Yeah,
it was called the Moosetrap, okay? So I'm waiting. The only mouse I saw come out of the kitchen. In fact, I think they keep mice in there in case somebody orders ribs.
Oh, you know what we can do? We can open our own dinner theater. Yeah, that porch behind the lodge there, it holds maybe like 100 people, right?
Yeah, and at $30 a plate, that's a lot.
A lot, yeah. Oh, we're gonna need a play?
Well, we'll just take an existing play and we'll just change it just a little bit. You know, nobody around here will notice, that's for sure.
Well, yeah, that's true. Okay, well, what are we gonna do about actors?
Harold, whenever you have married men, you have actors.
Today's winner received this coupon for 200 air sickness bags. Ideal for carrying your lunch before or after you eat it. Okay, cover your ears, Harold. Mr. Green, you've got 30 seconds to get Harold to say this word. Company. Company.
Yeah, all right, Mike.
And go!
Okay, Harold, think. What do you call people who come over to your house?
My Dungeons and Dragons Club.
Okay, no, sir, that's my fault. Okay, what do you call people who come over to my house?
Exterminators.
No. Okay, a group of actors together form...
an unemployment line.
No, okay. If you have, like, maybe 20 guys in the army, yeah, that's called...
the Canadian military. Right?
You're almost out of time, Mr. Green.
No. Okay, Harold, let's say the day comes when you're going to get married, okay? So you would send out invitations.
What?
Harold Green requests the pleasure of your
daughter.
She'll come to me at the aisle.
There you go.
And now we come to the experts portion of the program, where we address those three little words that men find so hard to say.
I don't know.
Okay, today's letter reads as follows. Dear experts, we went on a long trip recently and my wife was driving, so I got a chance to look out the windows. I noticed that when you have two couples in the same car, there is a lot of seating choices. Can you tell anything about the couples based on where they sit in a car?
Well, you got to look at the level of conversation that's going on. Like, if the men are doing the talking, they're dating. If the women are doing the talking, they're married.
Great. And what if nobody's doing any talking?
They're married.
Well, what if everybody's yelling?
They're married. Now, if you got the two guys in the front seat and the women in the back seat, they're definitely married.
And if you got the two women in the front seat and the two guys in the back seat, they've been married a while.
Well, like, what if everybody's in the back seat?
They're dating.
You know, when Harold had his first business trip last year, the guys at the lodge were so happy he was going away, they all chipped in and got him one of these laptop computers. The problem is, the name laptop scares me because Harold's lap is no place for anything valuable. Which got me thinking, if they can make a portable computer, why can't some goofball make a portable desk? Well, guess what? Some goofball has. Now, this may look like a regular garment bag, but it's actually a business traveler's dream. If you do a lot of business travel, it might be a recurring dream or a recurring nightmare, depending on where you're going. Now, inside on top, we have our neatly folded suits. And underneath, we have our neatly folded desk. TV trays. They're not just for pathetic bachelors anymore. And of course, you gotta have a flashlight and a coat hanger. Those are essentials for any executive. Because what's a desk without a desk lamp? Now the rest is up to your imagination. The garment bag itself becomes my modesty panel, see? And I've added a pant hanger with the metal clips to my desk lamp. Of course, now you're not gonna hang your pants on there unless you work for the government. Instead, you're gonna hang the best part of your pants, your wallet, or as it's also known, your Rolodex. Of course, you can't travel without travel music. Transistor radio ought to take care of that, huh? Okay, now all we need is one of those fancy nameplates to add that final touch of sophistication. And there's our portable desk. It's quick, it's simple, and it's ready to hit the road. So remember, if the women don't find you handsome, they should... I want to talk to you older guys out there about the dangers of shopping for your wife. Most importantly, I'm talking about her reaction to that gift you just bought her. Now, I know some of you have been buying her gifts for 25 or 30 years, and you think you're getting pretty good at it. Well, you're not. The truth is that men run out of good gift ideas after about the fifth year of marriage. And that's when the phrase, "Oh, I love it, honey, it's just what I wanted," is replaced with, "Did you keep the receipt?" I know we've all been there. That time you bought her that picture of the dogs playing poker. Or the year you enrolled her in the barbecue sauce of the month club. Remember when you got her that hilarious fish that sings when you clap your hand? I'll tell you what the good news is, eh? You don't have to get too upset about it, because all you gotta remember is one important thing when you're shopping for your wife. Men are from Mars, women have taste. So the next time you're shopping for a gift for your wife, look around the shop. If you see something kind of special, something unique, something that you would honestly like to have for yourself, get the heck out of there, because, buddy, you're in the wrong store. Remember, I'm pulling for you. We're all in this together. Well, Buster Hatfield wrote up the script for our dinner theater play. Rehearsals start today. I'm not actually in it because I'm allergic to vegetables. Especially when people are winging them at me.
Red.
It's not a ballet, you know.
This is an acting technique. We have to divest ourselves of our own personas so we can take on a new character.
And in your case, it's probably a good idea.
There's a typo in the script, Red. Buster called it the Moosetrap instead of the Mousetrap. See?
No, it's not a typo. It's the Moosetrap. It's loosely based on the Mousetrap.
It's identical! Same plot, same characters?
No. See, ours is called the Moosetrap, see? That way we don't have to pay any royalties.
No? The Moosetrap has been running for 50 years, Uncle Red. We're not gonna fool anybody.
Don't be so sure, Harold. The mayor of Possum Lake's been running for 60 years, and he still fools everybody.
You know what? We need to rehearse this, because Anne-Marie is gonna be in the audience, and I get enough bad reviews at home.
All right, well, let's do Act 3, Scene 4. The bloody aftermath.
Now, Uncle Red, as an actor, I'm unsure of my motivation in this scene. You know, I was hoping maybe you could help me with that.
Yes, okay. Yes, I can, Harold. I can, okay? So your motivation is to do what it says in the script. We get somebody else to play the part.
Okay, see, I needed that.
Yes. Yeah. Yes, I did too.
Okay.
All right, Dalton, go ahead. You got the first line.
You know, it's just that I'm nervous, you know, and I don't want to be the worst one up there, so.
Yeah.
You've got some nerve, little man. But maybe if we work together, we could find a copy of the old lady's will.
Looks like you're safe.
I think so.
I was killing time up behind the lodge, waiting for Walter. That's when drums, you know, they just get drumming away there, and you got to get a beat going. And Walter had kind of a Chinese thing going, which was perfect. And I didn't understand that at first, but apparently he had gotten himself some new little toy that he wanted to try. He wanted me to be kind of the guinea pig on. They use these things now in some of the big cities, not just in China, but everywhere. And it's called a rickshaw. And they pack up pretty small, for the size of it, and. So Walter wanted me to get in there, so I said, "Yeah, all right, I'll give that a chance." And I feel like the shove somewhere, and I'm sitting there, and then he takes her. I don't know exactly the, understand the physics of this, and I'm questioning it. Oh, that has got to hurt. Apparently, I wasn't sitting far enough back. I got to put the weight back like it is on my ass, and then there, look at the way he runs scares me, to be honest with you. But as we started going up a hill, again, I guess my weight was too far forward, and he started to dig in a little bit. So he asked me, if I would move back, and I probably overcorrected. And I knew this can't be good. Oh. Okay, you know what? That's enough fun for me for one day. Why don't you get in there, Walter, and I'll try. Yes, let me try that. I'll try that. Yeah, but I'm not actually going to pull it manually. That seems like a better idea to me. Now my plan was to take him up onto the four lane, but I had to go up a hill first, and some of the hills around Possum Lodge are not all that smooth, and I hit a pothole, and I probably should have had some kind of a hitch, because. So we decided we should just put the rickshaw away for the day. And now I came in there. I came in there hoping that Walter was okay, and it was like going to the vet. He had one, like those dogs where he had one of those. That was just his hat. I took that off, and that had damaged his ears. Then I could yell at him, and so it's a great hat. It was a great day, and we'll probably never do it again.
Oh, hi, everybody. Ranger Gord here with another one of my animated educational shorts. Now, this particular one is all about pollution. And more specifically, I'm against it. You know, when I'm in the great outdoors, I always hearken back to that old adage, take nothing but photos, leave nothing but footprints. Unless, of course, you're out there doing something weird, in which case those things will be used against you as evidence later on. Seriously. Anyway. Enjoy the film.
Hi, folks. Today I'm going to teach the whole world to clean up its act. But first, we need a mascot. Why? Here's a cute little fellow. Can you say, give a hoot, don't pollute? Hmm?
Can you say trademark infringement?
Right then. Let's begin our lesson with noise pollution. Now, obviously, we can't have this kind of noise in the woods. It's impolite, irresponsible, and incredibly dangerous.
So is the music!
And here comes the hibernating bear we just woke up to finish the job.
What do we do, Gord?
I know. Why don't you take this motorcycle to safety?
Good idea. Hey, sweet ride.
Yeah, sweet nitrous oxide ride, you mean. Greenhouse gases are a constant threat to us all. But fortunately, you can't do too much damage. With a potato in your tailpipe.
I'm gonna put a potato in your tailpipe, Gord.
Well, there'll be plenty of time for recreation later, Red. Now, let's fly this chopper.
I can't believe you're making us pick up litter in the dark.
The pollution solution is a 24/7 job, Red. Now you know what I go through every day.
Yeah. It's amazing how much garbage people leave around a campsite. Ha ha.
Actually, it's not a campsite at all, Harold. You've been cleaning my place for the past hour.
This isn't your apartment, Gord.
You're right. Whose place is this?
Well, folks, we've had a lot of fun tonight. But there's nothing funny about pollution.
You said it, Paul the Pollution Bear.
Ah, phew! So, he was your mascot all along. I thought he was going to attack us.
Oh, Paul's still going to attack you. Giving environmental tips is his job. Eating you is, well, it's just a perk.
wait a second, Paul. You don't want to eat me. I'm polluted.
Oh, it's true.
Well, the dinner theater thing seems to be going pretty well. We decided to serve hamburgers. We already had lots of hot dogs on stage. Is the play over?
Well, for us it is. That is the worst audience I've ever seen. They do not know how to appreciate good talent.
We don't know that, Harold.
They were throwing French fries at us. It was humiliating.
Well, look at the bright side. At least we didn't give them cutlery.
Oh, no, we can't go back out there, Uncle Red.
Well, how far into the play were you?
We were at the murder scene. Winston was dying.
We all were.
Well, that's enough of that. That
audience has no respect for the dead.
Right now, they envy the dead, Wisdom.
It was awful. I'm laying there on the stage, and they're pelting me with mustard and hot peppers and Tabasco sauce.
Are you all right, Winston?
Yeah, I'm okay. A little heartburn, but... Meeting time.
Yeah, okay, you guys go ahead, all right? I'll be down in a minute.
Listen, the butler did it, okay? I'll be downstairs.
Okay, my wife is watching. I'll be coming straight home after the meeting. Dinner theater thing didn't go so good. Wasn't really Broadway, not even off-Broadway. It was just off. Which, coincidentally, was part of the phrase the audience was yelling. And to the rest of you, thanks for watching. On behalf of myself and Harold and the whole gang up here at Possum Lodge, keep your stick on the ice.
All right.
Quando, Omni, Flunkus, Moritati.
Sit down.
All right, men, bow your heads for the man's prayer. I'm a man. But I can change. If I have to, I guess. All right, man, the whole dinner theater thing, that's all over with. And we have some food left over. We got 40 pounds of ground beef, 65 pounds of French fries, and I'm not exactly sure how much ham. What do you guys weigh?